I want to touch on a couple of things just so that we can be in the right state of mind to participate in communion. You know, there's not a lot of order in most people's lives. They're burdened. They're burdened by chaos. They're burdened by their responsibility. They're burdened by the weight of marriage. They're burdened by the weight of having children, maybe disobedient children, maybe the prodigal son or daughter. Maybe they're burdened by the fact that they've lost someone, or they're just burdened by their own constant failure. They're beat up and they're sinful and they're ugly and they know it, and they have no peace in their life. Jesus says in Matthew, I don't know if you need to bother looking for it. It was the last couple of verses in my notes there. Matthew 11:28. Jesus comes to the world when it's in complete chaos again. Yeah, there's a lot of order as well, but spiritually it was chaotic. Nobody was reaching to God the way that they ought. Nobody was coming to God. They couldn't come to God. And now Jesus comes on the scene and he says, "Come to me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." The reason I quoted this passage is I was going to refer back to the day of rest that God created, and we'll touch on that next time. But God has created a rest for your soul. Jesus says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden." Do you feel in your spirit, in your soul, that you don't have rest? Are you constantly burdened by the trials of life? When you have this rest, I want to tell you that you can do the trials of life with joy and with thanksgiving. Will it become hard sometimes? Yes, but the joy of the Lord is our strength. "Come to me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls." That's what you need. That's what you need to labor well. That's what you need to be able to have the fortitude to bring order to your chaos. You need rest in your own soul. If you're constantly struggling in your own soul, how are you going to bring rest and peace to your family? How are you going to bring order to the chaos in your home, in your house, in your room, in your car, wherever it might be? How are you going to bring order if you yourself are in chaos? It was actually this very similar thought that brought me to the Lord so many years ago. I was actually, Hallie is 17 now. She was about 5 months old. So almost 17 years ago now, that I was troubled in my soul because I had this little precious baby holding her in my arms and she meant the world to me. It was love at first sight. There is no other time when love at first sight is more true than when you look at that little child as a man. And I think for women, it's love long before first sight. But the man looks at that child and is immediately enthralled. But also the weight and the burden of raising a child fell on my shoulders like lead. I was like, man, oh man, how am I going to raise this child? We read a book on child training. And I realized that I needed to teach this child to know God, the author of life, the giver of life. And then I recognized, I don't know God. How am I going to offer joy and peace and life and knowing God to a child that's going to grow up and face eternity when I myself don't know God? And I came to that realization that the burden was too much for me to bear. And I was sitting next to John Dyke so many years ago. We go way back to the very point of my birth. Sitting next to him in a semi-truck delivering windows out in Ohio. And we heard a preacher on the audio that we had in the stereo there listening to several messages that day, but two of them I remember so plainly. One of them, he drew an image visually for me of Jesus, and he says, in the book of Isaiah, it says that he was marred more than any man. And it says that they ripped out his beard in the book of Isaiah. It prophesies that of Jesus. And he says, I pictured Jesus' body looking more like hamburger meat by the time he was done than a human being. He was marred, scarred, made a mess of more than any other man that's ever been. And I just was overwhelmed by the fact that the Son of God had been so marred more than any man to the point where he was unrecognizable. And it made me feel ugly and dirty and sorrowful and sad. But then the very next message we listened to is a different preacher now. He pictured Jesus on the cross, and he submitted this to me, and it's always stuck with me. He says, that should have been you. on that cross, hanging there, beaten, bloody to a pulp, pierced through with nails, hanging for the world to see in shame and dishonor, the perfect, spotless Lamb of God hanging there, it should have been you. And I realized suddenly, it was me. It should have been me. I belong there. I have deserved that through my dirtiness, through my filth, through my sin. And without me realizing it, till maybe like a month later, the burden rolled off my back right there. Because I recognized that I have it. The weight has been lifted. I know God through the suffering of Jesus. If he died for the sins that I committed, and it should have been me on that cross, then that means I don't have to deal with my sin anymore. They have been lifted. It has been taken away. I'm not asking God to forgive my sins. I'm not pleading with him to take my sins away. I'm looking to the cross and I'm seeing the suffering of Jesus and I know that my sin was done away with at the cross. It should have been me on the cross. He suffered in my place. He took my sin upon himself and he died as if he were me and my sin was done away with. Therefore, now I conclude I am free. And my first thought, and this is the reason why I look back on that time about a month later, my first thought, I said to John recognized what was going on. He turned the stereo off. And I just said, what about Neil and Joe? I think it was those two that came to mind. I have got six brothers, but those two immediately came to my mind. My one older brother and one younger brother. I think it was those two, if I remember correctly. What about them? What about me? Well, immediately I had recognized I was there. My sin was removed. It's taken away. It's dealt with. It's paid for in once for all, in full. How about those guys? I mean, they should know this too. Immediately my mind stepped away from me and started looking to others. They need to know this. I've got to tell them. They've got to understand this. Your friends need to know it. Your family needs to know it. The world around us needs to know it. There's life after this life. The real life begins after this life. And we have been given full order and complete access to the throne of God by a gift, by the death of the Son of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we come up here this morning and participate in the bread, I know it's just bread. The Catholics have taught that it's actually the body. It's not the actual body. We're remembering the fact that when he died, we should have died. When his body was beaten to that bloody pulp, it should have been us, and the wages of sin were completely placed upon him, and his body was beaten, and we are free now from the penalty of death. And his blood was shed to pay for our sins. So not only have they been paid for, not only did God see righteous punishment upon sinners in Jesus, but then he raised them again to new life, and he promises us now that we should continue to remember this until he comes. He's coming back, folks. We don't live for this world. He's coming back and he's going to receive us unto himself. You can experience joy in the chaos right now, and you can bring a bit of order to your chaos right now if you understand what he's done for you. If you understand the suffering Savior and the atonement that he made. So as you come up here, you're not getting the body and blood. You're remembering the body and the blood. Come and partake joyfully and thankfully. Remember what he did for you. And give thanks and praise to God this morning. Amen. Is there any questions or thoughts on that? I know there's a lot.
The thing I was thinking, I appreciate the way you shared the ending here about the body and the blood. It really, you know, I feel like sometimes, you know, we are worshiping Jesus or whatever, but Jesus was our avenue to God. We were in trouble with God. I so appreciate, you know, that Jesus is on the right hand of the Father right now, making sure my relationship is always intact. Mm-hmm. And for me not to be able to have that all of a sudden would seem like I don't know what was my point of living anyway then. Like, where would I go or whatever when I go up and I take the bread and the wine. I am really reminded that I actually have a relationship with the Father because somebody gave me a relationship, a reason to live, and I really appreciate that. And I was also thinking about the Trinity. You were talking about that Mike Pearl's quote there. It seems to be in creation everywhere. Kent Hovind actually has a very simple little thing too about the Trinity. He says the Trinity is actually in the first verse. And he says, time, space, and matter already is mm-hmm. a proof of Trinity. And he says, in the beginning, that is time, was the heaven, that is space. And he created the earth, that is matter. So those three already. And then time has present, past, future. Space has length, width, and height. And earth, which is matter, has solid, liquid, and gas. So it all points to the creation or to the Trinity. And it's somehow so mingled together. We just listened to a little message too. Somebody said that God or Jesus never actually claimed to be God. But there's so much evidence in God or in Christ's life on earth that we can say that he is the Son of God. He didn't actually say that I am God really ever, except I am that some of those things that Henry was going through. And everything together to me just feels like the communion. It makes me part of all that, or I'm tied to it. Without it, I'm nothing. Mm-hmm. So I'm really thankful for it. I know I'm rambling on a bit, but.
Any other thoughts about the message at all? Another thing I want to open up, and I think we probably have lacked this as a church, is some churches focus very much on confession for communion, like as if they're trying to make themselves right before they take communion. I don't think that's the right step. But at the same time, if you feel like you've been neglecting the church, if you feel like you've been taking for granted the body of Christ, that's what 1 Corinthians 11 talks about, right? You're eating and drinking unworthily by not observing or not considering the Lord's body. If you have a confession to make, I'd strongly encourage you to come up here and just let us know where your heart's at, where your thoughts are, what you've been struggling with perhaps, and let people know that I am trusting in the blood of Jesus. I'm completely content with the sacrifice, and I know I'm right with God, but I also want to be open and clear before you all, right? So it's a good time for us to come up and open up. Anybody that feels right now that they should probably come up and share something? A lot of pressure. All right. I think we'll probably be singing some songs, I would imagine, while we partake. And the basement folks are going to be coming up first, Abe was saying. So those of you in the basement, you can get ready. Thanks for tuning in online at home as well. I realize there's more people watching sometimes than we think about. And we appreciate you thinking about us here, praying for us. A lot of wisdom needed in so many ways. So thank you again.